33, 1492, 1789, 1914, 1945. How did such dates creep into our collective memory? Who decided which ones were memorable? How is an event constructed? Why? And for whom? And how does it end up in the history textbooks? The historian, Patrick Boucheron, looks back at some of these famous dates to see how they help us grasp the broader sweep of world history. After all, there are many different calendars in the world. Not one version of history, but a multitude of intertwined histories. So let's pan out, take a different perspective, and study with Patrick Boucheron the mechanism by which history is made. Crucifixion is an appalling way to inflict pain. Before it came to symbolize Christianity, the cross was nothing more than an instrument of torture. For historians, it was perhaps the least uncertain evidence of Christ's existence. Why invent such a brutal and shameful story if it wasn't true? But Christianity is all about making a date with incredible events.
If I say I was born in 1965, I mean 1,965 years after Jesus Christ. And if saying that is a pain in French, I say in our era, which isn't great either, because who does we refer to? We meaning the Christians? So is the Christian era a global phenomenon? We need to talk about how Christianity came to colonize time. Christian time has a direction. It begins with Christ's birth. But its way forward, the direction it takes, its hopes, lies in the crucifixion. That is the main date in Christian history. But what is that date? It's hard to say. The event must have happened between 27 and 33 AD. And yet all founding dates, from the creation of Rome to the Hegira, are similarly a way of situating a story, saying, this happened here, and the story goes on. Dating is all about setting a story in a particular space, one to tell it from, to remember it by, and for people to come back and to commemorate the event that happened. Of course, this place has a name in Christianity, one that is shared in Islam and Judaism too, and that place is Jerusalem. So that's where we're going, to Jerusalem, where it all began. A man preached there. He was Jewish. His disciples quoted his words and even said that he performed miracles. According to the Bible, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. This has been the Christian creed since the First Council of Nicaea in 325. People say that Jesus rose from the dead on the third day to save men's sins, and that he will return at the end of time to judge the living and the dead. Did he really exist? Most modern historians believe so, yes, meaning the history of the crucifixion can be written. But it's difficult, because the Gospels, which tell the story of the life of Jesus and announce the good news of his resurrection, disagree on many details. The Church recognizes four, the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Why four Gospels? After all, one would be simpler. There are no contradictions. Maybe the Church likes contradiction. We mustn't forget that Christianity was a cult of Judaism, a successful one, but a cult nonetheless.
mais c'est une secte du judaïsme. Ça veut dire.
That means two things.
Ça veut dire d'abord.
Firstly, it comes from it and wants to separate from it.
Mais ce qui.
But one thing that certainly doesn't separate Judaism from Christianity is that both religions inspire endless commentary. And to be able to keep talking about them, there must be conflicts. Setting aside the somewhat insistent and closed world of the four Gospels, it's worth remembering that during the first century, just as the Gospels were beginning to be written, a Jewish man named Flavius Josephus was telling the same story. The great expert on his work is Étienne Nordet, a Dominican historian who teaches at Jerusalem's École Biblique. Flavius Josephus was a priest from Jerusalem who was born in 37 AD and died sometime between 95 and 100 AD. So he was a native of Jerusalem, highly cultured and rather vain. He talks about his life in a somewhat conceited way, but he is the only Jewish historian to prioritize facts and not interpretation, whereas both the Bible and the New Testament confuse facts with interpretation. What do these facts tell us about God? Josephus was very suspicious about such approximations. He was resolutely rational.
Flavius
Josephus, who wrote a major book called The Jewish War, resituated the story of Jesus within a Roman chronology. He put it back in its right proportions as well. That's to say, a minor event in the history of the Roman Empire. Look at the map. This is the eastern border of the Roman world. Judea was, at that time, a province of Syria, managed by a power which in the modern era would be described as colonial. The Romans were backed by a puppet Jewish monarchy, that of Herod the Great, whose capital was Caesarea on the coast. The city of Jerusalem was thus both dominated and diminished, literally marginalized away from the major economic flows. Roman order was imposed in a brutal and authoritarian manner, via the prefects who governed in the emperor's name. Pontius Pilate was the prefect of Judea from 26 to 36 AD. An inscription about him was found in Caesarea, probably a remnant from an edifice dedicated to Emperor Tiberius. His name can be clearly read, Pilate, prefect of Judea. So he is the historical linchpin of the story, the person who anchors it within the chronology of the Jewish anti-establishment movement. The revolts are linked to what was known as messianism. That's to say, the wait for a savior who would restore an authentic Jewish monarchy. This was the political movement that Josephus wrote about.
Dans sa première, version,
in the first version, written in Greek, of the Jewish War, before the emperor officially censored it, a few notes are provided about characters from the New Testament, including a certain miracle worker who would cure ailments and was held in very high regard by many of the people around him. In particular, he had 150 devotees who wanted him to go down to Jerusalem and seize power, or at least chase out the Romans, possibly killing Pilate.
We know what happened next. Jesus didn't assassinate Pilate. He was judged and sentenced to die on the cross. And this very choice of torture betrays the political nature of the affair. Jesus was killed as a rebel. King of the Jews. In the Gospel according to St. John, Pilate had that ignominious and mocking sign placed on the cross. That's why painters sometimes show the Latin acronym INRI above the cross, meaning Jesus Nazarenus Rex Iudaeorum, or Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. In 1968, in a funeral urn in the suburbs of Jerusalem, archaeologists found the heel of a man named Yohanan, presumed crucified in the first century AD. The placing of the nail gives the position of the legs, not side by side, but on either side of the cross. Other nails driven through the wrists, allied to a system of ties, lighten somewhat the weight of the body. It was all designed to provide a slow and appalling death, with the death throes given a public showing as the victim gradually expired.
On crucifie les rebelles, on crucifie les esclaves.
Rebels and slaves were crucified. Think of Spartacus. Thieves, too, were crucified. Anyone too unimportant to be beheaded was crucified.
Donc c'est infamant.
So it was an ignominious end.
De ce signe, la croix.
Using the sign of the cross as a rallying point for a belief in Christianity was regarded as scandalous, ridiculous almost, by those whom the missionaries wished to convince and convert.
Parce que les missionnaires veulent convaincre et convertir.
And yet it was the symbol that later became established as the rallying sign for all Christianity. Around 1000 AD, as the image of Christ on the cross spread, a glorious and impassive Christ was depicted. Then, little by little, the characters and symbols described by the evangelists crept into the scene. By the 12th century, Christ's head has fallen to one side. His body sags and the focus is on pathos. Jesus is shown as a man suffering, one that the Christians who celebrate his death and resurrection every Sunday can identify with. But while the crucifixion has its place in liturgical time, its precise date remains a historical mystery. When exactly was Jesus crucified? We know it happened under Pontius Pilate, so that makes it between 26 and 36 AD. John says the crucifixion took place on the 14th of the month of Nisan, the first in the Hebrew calendar. There are thus 11 possible dates. But Mark and John agree that Jesus died on a Friday. Astronomical calculations tell us that during Pilate's 10-year term, the 14th day of Nisan fell on a Friday four times, in 27, 30, 33, and 34 AD. 27 AD is too early. John the Baptist had not yet begun preaching. 34 AD is too late. John had already been converted. That leaves 30 and 33, and experts hesitate between the two.
There's a small clue that the year was 33 rather than 30, because knowledgeable astronomers have shown that on that particular evening, there was a partial eclipse of the moon after the sun went down, which could be seen in Jerusalem for about 40 minutes.
And there's a prophecy in the Old Testament by Joel which states, "The sun will turn to ashes and the moon to blood before the Lord's day comes." So the eclipse of the moon argues in favor of 33, as the Gospels are less interested in relating events than in making people think that it had been prophesied in the Bible. In that case, the crucifixion occurred on Friday, April the 3rd, 33. But to say that, you have to use a calendar which did not yet exist. So for the Romans, we are in 786, and for the Jews, in 3793. In both cases, the date barely caused a ripple. Not until much later, in the second and third centuries, did the Christian cult develop and spread beyond Judea. Another century later, the first pilgrims began to walk the streets of Jerusalem. To test their faith, Christians wanted to walk in Christ's footsteps. They were looking for the site of the Passion, seeking out places on the ground to fit the story into.
Walking in the footsteps of Jesus. While unsure exactly who that is, people want to come, so it's feet first. Hence, a number of stations sprung up on both the left and right-hand sides. One group comes along with a page from the Old Testament or the Gospels. Yes, that's not bad. Another group comes along and likes it too. Next, it's a peanut vendor, a restaurant, a church. It ends up as a holy place.
But where to locate the crucifixion? The Gospels don't provide any precise information. Close to the city, says John, which means not within it, so outside the walls. It must be a high-up place, since it's called Golgotha, meaning place of the skull, or Calvarius in Latin, from which we get the word Calvary. The question of location was particularly acute in the early 4th century, when Emperor Constantine became a convert and made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire. In 325 or 327 AD, Helen, the mother of the Christian emperor Constantine, invented the cross. Meaning what exactly? Meaning she found the place, so it is claimed, where the relic was in the ground, waiting for her. Christ's cross, which had been buried. This underground place is now called the Chapel of the Invention, where the Holy Cross, the only relic left by Christ resurrected, is worshipped. But it's only a small part of this monumental complex, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, because after discovering it, Helen dreamed up a whole setting in which to stage the memory. A few dozen meters from where she discovered the cross, she identified the site of Golgotha, and then Christ's tomb. The sepulchre itself, a simple grotto dug out of a quarry. Modified and rebuilt many times, the current church completely covers and encloses all those holy places. Golgotha is now accessed by a staircase which opens onto a double chapel, half Aramaic with Latin rites, half Orthodox with Greek rites. Because since the 16th century, the task of administrating these holy places has been shared by the various Eastern communities. In the Orthodox chapel, pilgrims meditate on the hole left where the cross itself was planted into the ground. They emulated what people were already doing in the Middle Ages, trying to slip their hand or place their head in the impression, as if to physically measure up the key sites of the Passion. A little further on is the Stone of the Anointing, on which Christ's body was washed and wrapped in the holy shroud. Because what is revered here are traces, impressions, and absences. Today in the Holy Sepulchre, you see nothing. But the point isn't to show things. What you are seeing, basically, is a mass of history, all the complexity of a story which is almost crushed, being condensed, as it is, into such a small space. The overall effect produces an extraordinarily muddled sense of confusion. That muddle reflects the bumpy and hotly disputed history of Jerusalem. The history, too, of the rifts between different religions and different denominations within a single religion. Of the Christian denominations, there is one whose desire for rationality finds it hard to accept the inextricable and gleaming mass of the Holy Sepulchre. In 1884, a British evangelist by the name of Charles Gordon claimed to have found the real site of Christ's crucifixion. It stands at the foot of a cliff which has the good fortune to look like a skull, and so can remind us of Golgotha. In particular, it's well outside the city walls of the Herod era, identified by architects. Since then, urban expansion has badly obstructed the viewpoint, tending to dispel any mystical fervor. But the process is not quite finished. It's unfinished time-wise because Jesus was judged, died on the cross, and rose again from the dead. But now he must go to heaven. But the process is not quite finished. It's unfinished time-wise because Jesus was judged, died on the cross, and rose again from the dead. But now he must go to heaven. Nor is it finished as far as physical space is concerned, because the whole of Jerusalem has not yet been invested by places relevant to Christ's life. Opposite the Holy Sepulchre on the Mount of Olives, where Jesus stayed before his trial and crucifixion, Constantine had a large basilica built. All that remains today is a chapel built by the Franks. It was open air until Saladin covered it with a dome to turn it into the Mosque of the Ascension. This marks the spot from which Jesus left the earth after resurrection. Another empty space and other print, the one left by Christ's foot as he rose to heaven. From the Mount of Olives, you can glimpse Temple Mount and the Dome of the Rock, where the Prophet Muhammad also left his footprint. This is opposite the Lost Temple, in front of the Golden Gate, which will open on the Day of Judgment. Time is no longer about constant renewal or a wait for the Messiah, as in the time of Judaism, a time of waiting. Christian time is, of course, directional. It's a religion that steps away from the cyclical time of religion. It is, to all intents and purposes, a historical religion based on a historical datable character. That's why we can say that Christianity colonizes time. Its origins, defined by the event that was the life of Jesus, take us into a time that is linear and historical. And the calendar is what establishes the Christian idea. One last mystery remains to be unraveled. When did our era begin? On the day of Christ's crucifixion or that of his birth? The Council of Nicaea in 325 sets out the belief of Christ's crucifixion as the basis of the creed and its beliefs, meaning that the Christian era begins with the Passion. So a cyclical calendar of the Easter dates based on the dates of Christ's Passion, known as a computus, begins to take shape. And all that carried on until 525, when a monk by the name of Dionysius Exiguus invented a new way of counting time. According to him, time begins in the year 1, the year of Christ's birth. This change of era was adopted by the Pope, but not generalized until the 10th century. And it was probably not until the 15th or 16th century that the era of the Nativity burst into collective representations and became a common way of dating. So in the end, the era of the Passion lasted a very short time, from 325 to 525, a period of 200 years. One can speculate as to what might have happened. How would the centuries have been counted today had Dionysius Exiguus not had his strange idea? Our whole system of counting would be shifted back 33 years. In the calendar of the Passion, the 20th century would have begun neither in 1900 nor in 1914, and would thus have rid itself of the First World War. But it would still have begun tragically in 1933 with the arrival of Hitler. Furthermore, we would still be living in it. But who are we, having such difficulty grasping the variety of world calendars? We may be convinced that we are living in the 21st century, but this is also the 15th century of the Hegira and the 58th of the Hebrew calendar. So let's continue our disorientation exercise. What happened to the world during Christ's life? At that time, Emperor Augustus published a decree ordering a census of the whole world, as recorded in St. Luke's Gospel. But that event probably dates back to 15 AD and only concerned Syria. If any emperor could ever have made a census of the whole earth, it wasn't Augustus, but rather Han Pingdi, the penultimate representative of the Western Han dynasty. In 2 AD, he took a census of the world's most populous empire and declared that there were 58,671,400 Chinese. Other religions took off in the world around the same time. The Eastern religions in Rome, and in particular the cult of Mithras in Persia, and the great vehicle school of Buddhism in India. There are as many calendars as there are religions. What is striking in Jerusalem is the sight of memories clashing, physically and painfully. Jerusalem is not a Christian city. It is a Jewish, Muslim, and Christian city. Places are fought over, almost entangled in painful confrontation. On the other hand, Christian time has imposed itself on the world, and it provides a striking contrast. The colonization of spaces is so difficult, fierce, and conflicting, while the colonization of time seems so imperceptible and gentle. But it is actually a false gentleness because it is pernicious. When we see such and such a year in our time, we are supposing or pretending to believe that the whole world complies with the Christian calendar. In physical spaces, you can clearly see places that are disputed. But all in all, time is easier to colonize than space. Thank you.